Avinash, finally we are doing our post Bulbul interview. Huge congratulations on the series, Maya. I think it's just I'm just so proud to see you get so much acclaim and so much love. How are you feeling right now?
First of all, thank you so much. Thank you so much for acknowledging me, one, and think that it's important to take my interview. I'm so glad you thought of me. Second, yes, it's been amazing. Yeah, it's been amazing that people have really loved the film, loved every facet of the film, and really enjoyed it. So I'm thoroughly ecstatic. And this is rare. It's very rare that every facet of the film is kind of appreciated, right from the cinematography to the performance, to the direction, to the set design, to the costumes. So yeah, it feels nice. Feels proud to be a part of a film like that.
Yeah, and I think the thing is, because I spoke with Trippi actually earlier as well, and I think she was sort of talking a lot about patience, and she kind of referenced your example as well. Like you've been working in this industry for so long now, and I think it's only recently where your
Yeah.
that sort of glass ceiling has shattered for you in terms of your career. How
Yeah.
satisfied do you feel? I mean, do you feel like it's been a bit of a long time coming, this sort of phase that you're seeing in the career trajectory at the moment?
Actually, there are two ways of looking at it, Anuj. And if anyone who happens to follow my work or goes back and checks it out, they would know that there has been decent work coming to me. It's not that, so I can't really be complaining that I didn't have work all these years. It's now that people have started noticing and talking about me. And in fact, that's one thing that I'm still dealing with, very honestly. I still feel that there are a lot more people who have, I mean, again, this can be a perspective, but have done hardly any work and have got a lot more acknowledgement and love from the media and the industry. So yeah, that is a feeling I do carry. But at the same time, the only difference that has happened is, like, someone like you is interviewing me today, and not 5 years back. And I don't know what I've done right or what has really happened for that to happen. I really can't pinpoint, but something has changed for sure, for sure.
No, definitely. And I think it's great as well to finally see this. And I think it's great because actors like yourselves are finally getting their dues. And I'm really glad. I mean, I'm sure you've been seeing on Twitter, just to name a few of your fans, Sanya, Priley, and quite a few of and there's also a Twitter account by the name Ahista as well, that's also a huge fan of your work. And I'm sure you've been seeing all the posters and pictures that they're posting as well. So how does it make you feel to sort of get that experience where you have people sort of looking up to you and sort of reacting to you? I mean, what sort of emotions or thoughts go in your mind when you see that?
I think most importantly, along with the love that I've been getting, which is really, I'm eternally grateful for it. At the same time, there are a lot of DMs that I receive of people being really inspired with that journey of, of being almost non-existent to the world, and then suddenly spite up and say, "Hey, I've been here for so long. You saw me today. Hey, I've been here." And then discovering your work and realizing that, oh, they have missed out. There's so many people who have actually messaged and apologized for the fact that they missed out on Laila Majnu in the theaters, and all the other work that I've done. I feel amazing with the fact that the goodwill of Laila Majnu kind of translated into Bulbul to an extent, and the goodwill from Bulbul has reverted back to Laila Majnu. So a lot of people are discovering the earlier works that I had done. Which is amazing, which makes you feel like, oh, so it is there is some logic to saying that you have a quality kind of work behind you, and so that people, when they go back and check it out, they really their belief in you gets really cemented, and that is something that I'm really grateful for. I'm very, very happy for.
Yes, no, incredibly, and so you should be as well. So obviously, Bulbul is, far darker and more harrowing in comparison to what you've done so far as well. So it must have been quite, I mean, it must have been quite a heavy process, for you to sort of step into the shoes and sort of surround yourself in that sort of atmosphere.
Well, honestly, I was loving it because So, you know, when I was put into this setup of 1800s, where this guy comes back from London, so to wear the clothes that I'm wearing in the film, I don't get to do that on a daily regular basis, right? So it was amazing to be able to do that. I really enjoyed that. So the character that I was playing particularly in the film, Satya, to me, he was someone who was very naive. You know what I mean? He's very ignorant. He's
oblivious.
He's oblivious, and people like us would probably think of him as a dumb guy, which I did. I honestly thought of him as someone who's really dumb, and I happened to speak to Anvita about it, and I said, why am I doing this, you know? And then she mentioned about how Satya is this guy, he's like a Disney prince who goes out looking for the ones who are wrong and catches them, XYZ. That was exciting, but what really really excited me was the fact that, you know, Bulbul says this line to him, says, "Ab tum bhi unki tarah ho gaye."
Yeah, I remember.
And that really hit me. That because I didn't see Satya doing any wrong. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And yes, I have been I've always raised my voice for women empowerment and feminism, but I've also seen people making it a gender issue and kind of getting all men into the same conversation, which I kind of found always something that I resisted most of the time in my life. So when this happened, I wasn't sure. I really couldn't understand why does Bulbul say that he's one of them. And it's only when Anvita, and I really, really respect her views and opinions and how she looks at life, Anvita. So when she happened to tell me that maybe I'm a closet patriarch myself, which I wouldn't like, but I was willing to look at it and say, okay, that is a possibility, because we are so affected by our society and the system that we've been part of that we don't even realize it. We're not even aware. And which is what I thought was happening with Satya, because his intention was not to oppress her or be repressive towards her. It's just something that came out of the system that he was a part of. And that really opened my eyes. So I said, okay, I am literally playing a guy who is in the 1800s, but literally like 95% of the society today, most of them are those kind of patriarchs where they're not obvious, like an Indraneel and Mahendra, who come across as obvious patriarchs, but someone who, you know, like they are not even aware of it.
Right.
And if you are able to relate to them and if you're able to identify with them, people are able to identify with Satya, then there is a change that is, you know, there's a conversation which is very important and that we all start identifying if we are those closet patriarchs and make that change over. So for me, that was the most exciting part. The tough part being letting go of all the judgments that I had about him, willing and allow myself to be that ignorant and naive guy. And then maintain that balance so that everyone could relate to him and still identify the wrong that he did. So that was the most challenging part as an actor.
Right. No, absolutely. And I think the beauty of Bulbul is the fact that it makes all these sort of comments on society and issues within society in a very subtle way. I mean, that scene, I think, still strikes me as well. I still think about the scene is when I think the time when Binodini is sort of cleaning up Bulbul and she's like, kuch mat kehna and stuff like that. She's sort of, I guess, silencing her. And I think... Chup rehna, that's it. And I think that sort of scene just shows basically how much suffering has happened over time. I think it's always... See, we always hear about these things in history, but then I guess when we sort of see a film like Bulbul, it kind of just brings it to surface, which actually brings me to my next question as well. I mean, obviously, you know, it sort of tackles a lot of issues. Whilst it focuses on feminism, it also addresses deep-rooted issues like the patriarchy that's been happening for centuries now. What conversations do you think have started with the film?
So, like I said, the first one being, because I played Satya, people obviously have a conversation about that with you. A lot of people pointing out of, oh, he is a patriarch, obviously, you know. to some, he came across as an obvious patriarch for the things that he said. And then there were counters from the other people of, he's saying this because of XYZ reasons, you know. He's saying this because of this. And his intention is not to say that, you know. Like, I could have sat down and discussed the whole conversation with you. I don't think we have the time to do that. So those conversations became very interesting for me, because I suddenly felt, these are the things that I was thinking when I was justifying Satya in my head. And these are things that Anvita actually brought out to me. And I'm so glad these two things are coming out in the open and people are talking about it. So the only hope that you have is people could be deceptive like I was, and I was willing to. And if there was a willingness to accept that you might be wrong, I think that has been oppressed and repressed over the years, you know, with the things that we show in the film, right from child marriage to, the guy actually went out to study to London. Mm-hmm. The girl did not. You know, those are very small things, right? Even to the fact that the patriarchy shown by Indrani, where he could sleep with his brother's wife, but a platonic relation of his wife with his younger brother was something that he couldn't bear and couldn't understand. Those things have really become a part of the conversation. We're saying, you know, women have equal rights. If you can do it, then a woman should be allowed to do it. Having said that, I still believe there needs to be a definition for every relationship which is beyond gender. But considering the film was specifically talking about women empowerment and their oppression, that topic should be put aside for the moment.
Yeah, exactly. And I think the biggest issue as well is the hypocrisy that exists as well within our society as well. And I think what Bulbul does is that it does bring it to surface, like I mentioned and like you mentioned too. And I think it's great. But how important is it to have cinema like Bulbul, which obviously provides us with a seemingly supernatural coating, but yet sort of addresses these issues? So how pivotal is it to sort of get this sort of a combination in cinema?
Well, of what I know and the way I see it, I would never attempt or go for a cinematic experience that only gives me a message. Okay, because if I want a message, or if I want to personally deliver a message, I could just record it in a video and just put it across, you know, just say what I have to, and the message gets across. We go to watch films for the experience that it provides you. You know, it's something that you experience, the story, how engaging it is, how entertaining it is. And if by the end of the story, if you're able to provide a certain message which takes our humanity a step further, you would feel proud of that experience. You would be proud to be a part of a film like that. That it has hopefully tried to make five poor people be aware of their follies and maybe make that change, or at least be sensitive to the follies that are possible. Sure. And that you feel proud for. So yes, it is important, but I wouldn't say that I would do cinema, or cinema is only about
messages,
putting across a message to people. Yeah.
And I think I'm just very curious to sort of, imagine and sort of visualize if the film had released in cinema. I mean, I know it was made specifically for Netflix, but had the film released in cinema, in what way do you think audience reactions would have been different?
I really wouldn't know. This would be too much of a hypothetical situation for me. I definitely know one thing for sure, that people who saw it on the platform said they wish they had seen it on the bigger screen, because it is visually appealing and it is extremely cinematic. The whole experience is very cinematic. So yes, I'm sure they would have. I would like to believe it would be only positive from what I've understood and see people talking about. And hopefully it would, and if it had done well, like it has done on the platform, there would be more producers willing to throw money on us and make cinemas that we could be part of. That's what I can think of.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I'm really glad you mentioned producers as well, because Clean Slate Films in particular has always sort of provided a platform and a voice for unconventional content and fresh talents as well. So it must be, it's obviously very important, right, to have mainstream names like Anushka Sharma to support fresh talents like yourself and Tripti, right?
Of course. I mean, you know, when there are mainstream producers who back you, you know, they, because they are at a certain height of the industry, their voice is able to reach much farther, and the reach is much more. So when people like them back you, you are able to reach to a lot more people. Your voice is able to reach to a lot more people. So yes, it is absolutely. I mean, eventually that is what you're looking for as an actor, that you get backed by people who are at that height and who have the farthest reach, and that is how you can benefit as an actor. So yeah, I'm just glad that this happened with me. I'm just glad it has been happening with me. Though, I mean, I did my first film with Balaji Motion Pictures. Unfortunately, it did not get the reach that I thought it would, it should deserve. My second outing was Ghost Stories with Karan Johar, Dharma film. This one is Anushka Sharma, Clean Slate Films. I'm doing one with Reliance, and then I head to Excel. So thankfully, everything has been going pretty good, and mainstream producers are putting their faith in. And I just hope I'm able to justify their trust and you know, come back with good performances for them.
Yeah, no, definitely. And I'm sure you've obviously been seeing the conversations that are occurring a lot, especially of recent as well. And I've seen it's almost like as if people have kind of awoken to sort of supporting talents who haven't quite got their dues in this industry, or for example, talents who are fresh. So what change do you think will we see now in the industry, if at all, of any change? I mean, how hopeful are you of seeing more actors like yourselves who have been in the industry for so long, who have, I don't want to use the word struggle, but who have obviously been trying for so long and obviously have finally got the platform. So what change do you think we'll see in that?
Well, I'm sorry to say, I'm very cynical about this, okay? And I say this because it's very simple. It's not that the audience has done anything different. Neither is it that the industry has done anything different. It's just that we have a lot more platforms today. You know, it's the technology which has really brought in the change. And now that there are so many exhibition centers right in your hand, there needs to be a lot more content. And there needs to be a lot more content, there will be a lot of work given to actors. It's just that has made the change. The audience still goes and watches the same thing that they were watching, you know. But the only thing that happens now is because they are in a position to see more, you might get a diversified. So your taste has grown and diversified, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if the power centers, like how they exist, will still exist, because there is a possibility of just flattening it. There's a flattening of power, because it will get distributed because a lot more people are engaging to it. But as such, any major shift happening because of this, eventually it will be about business. If you are able to get the returns that we put in the money for, you will be called in and you will be given the job. If you're not able to do it, no matter how exceptional you are, you wouldn't get the chance. So the onus lied with the audience earlier, and it still lies with the audience. All we can do at this point of time, and all I try and do every time I get a chance to speak, is to tell the audience to say, "Ek bar na, please try and see, is it, try and be a better consumer," is all I want to say. Be a better consumer. Forget about what the industry is, how they are doing their work, how they are supposed to do their work, which everyone is so interested in, and figure out how to become a better consumer, not only for cinema, for everything in the world.
Sure.
You know, and make it about, is that what you're paying for worthy of your time and money? That's all that I want to say.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I think you've literally hit the nail on the head there. And I think what you said as well, I think I can also say that I'm a little cynical as well, but I think the change starts from us. You know, and if every one
Yes.
person can, you know, take that decision and that prerogative to make a change, then change can possibly happen as well, right?
Yeah, I mean, we've been talking about change in the cinema for ages now, Anuj. I still remember the cinema was changing when there was a Govind Nilani and Shyam Benegal, and then it came to present times when there was, you know, there was Sudhir Mishra and then Said Mirza, Ketan Mehta to then Ram Gopal Varma. Anurag Kashyap was a new change that happened. But the core essential cinema, mainstream cinema, remained the same throughout, and it is still the same. So when you're talking, the battle is only to become mainstream. Otherwise, there's a lot of opportunity for everyone, right? That's the only thing. There is a lot of opportunity for everyone, but it's just that once you become mainstream, you have more reach. So everyone wants more reach. That's the only fight that happens.
True.
And you can only hope that industry, like I've been studying a lot of patterns in various kind of industries. That's out of my interest. I'm not sure if your audience is interested in it, but I would want to share some
Please, please, yes.
insights. So I was reading something and I was watching a few interviews. Down south, they have decided to put a tap on the amount of money that will be spent on PR. It will be a one constant tap for everyone. Your film can be a 100 crore film. Your film can be a 5 crore film. This is the max that you can spend on the PR of your film. In a way, creating a even playing ground for all the people, saying with this money you can have this much reach. The same money this guy can put will have the same kind of reach, you know. And once that happens, the real talent and the real cinema and the art of it and all of that can reach out to the audience, and the audience can make the choice that they want to make. So it's a very interesting idea. It's a very exciting idea. I don't know how it makes. I mean, it will only see how it goes on. But I've also heard producers in Bollywood saying, or in Hindi film industry saying, that it is probably not feasible and nobody is accepting of it. Nobody wants to accept it. So it will take its own time to change. But there are things being done like that, and we are aware of it. So once it starts happening, starts showing benefits somewhere else, probably it will translate here as well. That's what I hope. Fingers crossed.
Yeah, no, and I think that's a very spot on point. And I think what's happened is because obviously you kind of mentioned about like it's not like you know the director anecdote that you just mentioned. I think perhaps because of the fact that it has been going for so long now, and suddenly now we've realized it's like holy crap, this has been going on. Like, what's happened? I think it's sort of rattled, I think, viewers a little bit. But I think you're right. I think, you know, films need to be made for the PR of cinema, not for the PR of cinema. I think that's definitely a sort
Yeah, so well said, man.
of. So I think
So well said.
that's definitely a caption that we can sort of, I guess, put out there for people to kind of mull over as well. But, you know, I think your filmography is very interesting. And I think when we did our initial podcast, you did say that, you know, you kind of have a thing for flawed characters or characters which are imperfect, completely, you know, are beyond this paradigms of this world. But obviously, your films are quite, the content and the sort of character graphs are quite dark. So where does this, so what, why do you sort of look out for these dark characters in particular? Is this something that you find fascinating, or is it because maybe there's some sort of darkness within you that you kind of find you know, that relatable with?
I really wouldn't think about it like that. I think it's more to do with, I think it's also a stereotype, very honestly. It's a cliché that, you know, if you're considered to be a good actor, then everything needs to be a little, dark, or it needs to be edgy, or, you know, those things happen. It takes a lot of time for you to justify and say, hey, I'm a good actor, then give me this opportunity. And once that happens, then you lose out on all the fun stuff as well, because hey, I'm here to do the fun stuff too, you know. But you're a good actor, so you shouldn't be doing the fun stuff. So yeah, I mean, my intention is not to say I don't want to do dark stuff. we all know that a gray character is more interesting than a white, black and white, you know, yeah. just something that is, which is why the Flaw kind of excites me. A man who is just white is very boring, and someone who's just black without the humanity or human side to him is something that is I wouldn't enjoy doing. So yes, I would say it comes more from the fact that I would enjoy flawed characters, but no, I don't think it comes from a certain darkness within. It's there might be, not that I'm aware of. I'm not sure of it.
So obviously the fact that you're playing such diverse roles as well, I mean, within that sort of frame and within that sort of style of characters that you're doing, they're also very different. They come from different paths and walks of life as well, in particular. Having done such versatile and interesting roles, is there anything in particular that you really are keen in doing and why?
Oh, yeah. You know what? Again, this might become a little controversial. I don't know if I should be saying this. So, for some reason, I saw Danish Girl after Leila Majnu. Okay.
Yeah.
And I was floored by the performance.
Okay. Yeah.
I absolutely thought that this is something that I would really also the you know, the way certain genders or people in our films have been presented, I just personally felt that there are more stories coming in and we need to reach out with their stories to the world. So I thought if there is anything like this happening in our country, I'll be jumping on it to do it. Yeah. Having said that, just 3 days back, I happened to see a tweet by Halle Berry saying she apologized for being interested in doing a transgender's part, and I just couldn't understand it, because like I told you, I was coming from this state of mind and intention that I wanted to do a part like this, and when I saw Halle Berry apologizing and being apologetic for the fact that she was interested in a transgender part, I got really flummoxed. And I want to understand. I put it out to the world, and my friends have been trying to make me understand that it is about representations of different kind of genders in cinema and society. But my job as an actor is to do different kind of parts, you know. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I mean, which is why I'm scared to say, but yes, I would be really, really excited to do a story which is done aesthetically and to with some authenticity. Of people with different genders. That would be really, really exciting. It will be stretching me a lot as an actor. And I know it will come with a lot of responsibility. So that's a challenge I would want to take.
I'm really glad you made this point as well, because often when we talk about, especially for example, like young actors playing elderly characters, or you have, you know, straight you know, heterosexual people playing homosexuals or any other member of the LGBTQIA community, there's often this dialogue about authentic casting. But do you think it's about the balance, right? I think it's about the balance of essaying that character in a way which is being respectful to that community, to that age, to that culture, per se. So do you think it's about the balance rather than actually the casting itself?
I think it's eventually it gets down to who's suitable to do that part the most, you know. How do I say? Again, I'm so scared that it might be not the right thing to say, or I might be just misinterpreted for what I'm saying. Let's give an example. Appu Raja is a film that Kamal Haasan did where he played a midget. Okay, and I'm sure there are midget actors as well. If you ask me, would I choose a Kamal Haasan to do that part, or would I ask a midget to play that part? You know, it's a question that I will ask myself. And having seen what Kamal Haasan did with that film, I don't think there is any actor in this world who should be doing that but him.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So for me, eventually, it comes down to who is the best suited for that part. The way I saw my job and my industry was, it was beyond the idea of race, religion, gender, caste, you know, all those age all these matters away. As an actor, I could play the oldest, the youngest, the richest, the poorest. And that is the reason I wanted to be an actor, because I could experience all of this, these things, and be empathetic to it and understand. When the counter is about representation, all I'm saying is I'm standing for it. I'm not saying that these films and these guys, and there should be films made of it. But if I get an opportunity to do something like this, I'm not going to let go of it. Mm-hmm. Because there is no representation for the other. You know, that's my only argument to this. And I wouldn't be apologizing for it, that I am doing this, and I or whether I should not be doing this, because this is what my job is.
Yeah.
Now, one can decide to make cinema about the same story and cast another, say, a gay guy or an older person or a transgender according to what they want to say in the story. That's up to them. It's their choice. Similarly, I have the freedom to make that choice and say, listen, I would love to do this. And I would do my best and come up with the most authenticity that I can come with. But don't take away my right to do it. You know, don't take that away from me. That's my job as an actor.
Yes. No. That's a very, again, very, very apt point as well. And I think often there's often this sort of skepticism regarding this is because obviously I think there's always that fear of an actor sort of not being able to play that sort of character correctly, like, you know, because often if we've seen in Bollywood, especially when it comes to members of the LGBTQIA, it's only recently where we've had a bit more of an a fair representation, if I can even use the word fair, but that's a bit which is not stereotypical. Like obviously you've had, you know, Shubh Mangalzada Savdhan, Ek Ladki Ko Dekha, and even when we talk about transgenders as well, we even had Paresh Rawal in Tamanna, who played the role very well. And I know this is, again, a very heavy question, but when do you think this whole stereotyping culture in Bollywood will stop? Be it of religion, race, gender, caste, all of that. When do you think that can all stop? Can it stop?
Yes, it will. It's not something that will stop, but yes, it will find its balance. And that can only happen, I'll tell you what the major, and again, I might be wrong about this insight, but what I understand is, it's now that we as a world have started seeing each other a lot more because of the internet, right?
Yeah.
We see each parts of the world, we see each kind of, now we suddenly know the world is so very diverse and so very big, because we thought this is what the world is, you know? And now when you see that, you have to start adapting to it. You cannot expect people to adapt just like this once who have been, you know, been inculcated this kind of idea for such a long time in life. It is now that they start saying, oh, they have to make a change. They have to adapt. So I see it both ways. Yes, there needs to be a change, but we also need to be patient about it. Now, people will say, well, when, how long, how much should we wait? But yes, do you see there is a change happening? Is there a shift happening? Yes, and we need to acknowledge that. If I was really for a movement, I will start talking about the idols of the movement rather than complain and crib about people who are not doing it right, you know. So I really want to start saying, okay, these are the people who are doing it right. Let's create idols, because that's how our cultures function, you know.
Yes,
especially in India. India is a culture which has only made idols as a way of transmitting the good and the bad. And so we need to do that. We need to start showing that these are the good things, and need to acknowledge and appreciate that. So once that starts happening a lot more, things will definitely make a change. It has already started changing, and I want to acknowledge it, because a lot of people don't. But I want to really stand out and say, listen, there is a shift. There is a change. Let's acknowledge it. Yes, it is slow. It's going to take time. But we are moving. You know, let's acknowledge that.
Yes, indeed. And also on a final note, Avinash, because we obviously spoke about the sort of roles that you want to do and what you specifically look out for in projects and all of that. I think we've had a few conversations actually in the past as well about that. But obviously having done, you know, work like Bulbul, which is obviously arguably perhaps your most like, you know, I would say it's probably, I mean, it's obviously given you a huge platform in a sense, like, because obviously a lot of people now know you and recognize. I'm sure people knew you and recognized you from Laila Majnoo as well. But now that obviously Bulbul has happened, what change do you hope to see in the dynamics of your career from here on?
I really don't know. I don't know, because I my only thing is, okay, I know that there's a next film coming in. I was shooting for something.
Yeah.
I know that it's all taking a step forward. All the work that I have been doing has been, right from 2 AM on a Sunday, there was a step up from Laila Majnoo to Bulbul to The Girl on Train to Dongri to Dubai. I want to make a step up. But there is a new desire that has come in, and I can probably share that, which is to suddenly see that because of the reach, and especially with the platforms now, I want to reach out globally. I want to create newer markets, which are like, I want to say that, you know, that's my experience with Laila Majnoo also, suddenly realizing that I come from Bihar. So yes, I have an audience, a smaller audience in Bihar, but I also have an equally small audience in Middle East. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so I need to figure out, how do I find my audiences all over the world so that I can spread out? I cannot be one specific area, one specific place that I'm looking to, keep Mumbai or Delhi. That's the focus of our films. Mm-hmm. So if I could be professionally thinking, that is not as an artist, but also a professional, professionally, I would want to reach out globally to bigger markets and try and see where people can start liking my work. Who are the people who really appreciate my kind of actors? And that will be a journey from here on for the next 5 years at least.
Hmm. And you know, because you said you want to sort of, I guess, become a bit more globally appeal to...
I want to be a global icon, man. Global icon.
Maybe you already are. I think you're one step towards that anyway. But in an attempt to do that, do you think perhaps doing films or projects which sort of concentrate on different milieus, do you think that will help you in achieving that goal?
Different milieus, you're saying?
Yeah, milieus and cultures and societies, yeah.
Yes. So, I mean, the first step towards it is to making sure that you choose stories which are universal, which has universal appeal, which talk about stuff which everyone feels. What I experienced with Bulbul, and it's my learning that, like yesterday, I got a call from Belgium. Wow. And people there have really taken on the film. And the fact that they were so surprised to know that, oh, there are cultural similarities, like how we talk about Chudel, there are stories similar to that in their culture, and so you realize that, oh, I didn't know. Mm-hmm. I had no idea, right? My film reached out and I came to know about it. So yes, it does make sense that there are universal stories, but I don't think anyone can plan and make those choices. I don't think we give too much value to our will and choices. Eventually, like Imtiaz sir told me once, you can only do the films that come to you. So one can make choices out of what comes to me. But yes, this is one thought that will always be there. That yes, you would want to do stories which are different from each other. When you're doing different stuff is when you're trying to tap on different kind of markets, because this is what might work here. And then you obviously have to repeat a few things so that the audience that you already have gets satiated with, oh, saying, oh, he's back. You know, this is what we see. I'm saying all of these things as an audience first, you know, and secondly as an actor, because I've been an audience too, which is what we forget, that I'm an audience too.
Yeah.
And this is how I see work. And this is what I have been seeing, what appeals to me. So I'm coming from that space. I'm looking at as an actor, my profession, as an outsider, literally, I mean, as a third person, and trying to see how it should be. So yeah, let's see how it goes. Eventually, it gets down to what comes to me. But the idea is to reach out globally, yes.
Wow, that is, I think that is just so wonderful. And I think definitely I can only just see good things happening. You know, like I told Tripti as well, you know, I think from here onwards as well for you, it's only going to be upwards and upwards and upwards, you know, touch wood. And I'm sure it's all going to work out for the best. And I'm super excited to see your other works as well. I think we're all highly anticipating that. So hopefully we get a release date or any update on those contents too super soon as well.
Hopefully soon, Anuj.
Yes, definitely. But Avinash, thank you so much. Again, it's always such a pleasure to have you on Film Show Me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anuj. Absolute pleasure for me as well.
Oh, wonderful.
See you.
Take care, buddy. Thanks.
Bye. See you.